Our second scripture of the morning comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 24 through 26. Very truly, I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Thanks be to God for the reading of this word.
Have you been taught, and maybe you indeed believe, that death was never God's intention for creation, that if Adam and Eve hadn't sinned in the garden, everyone would live forever? That's not how I read the story. The curse isn't that humans won't live forever. In fact, the ground is cursed. When Adam and Eve eat the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, we read in Genesis 3, "Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil, you will eat food from it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow, you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken. For dust you are, and to dust you will return." The curse isn't death. The curse is hard work. Now, a couple verses later, there is a line that some people might point to as proof that death is a curse, and the Lord God said, "The man has now become like one of us, knowing good and evil. He must not be allowed to reach out his hand and take also from the tree of life and eat and live forever." So the Lord God banished him from the Garden of Eden to work the ground from which he had been taken. But this isn't the introduction of death to God's design, simply that the opportunity for immortality has been removed by sending humans out of the garden. Humans were already mortal if they would need to eat fruit from the tree of life to live forever. You can tell me what you think about all this in Wednesday's Bible study or chat about it after worship. I look forward to hearing your thoughts about what God desires for creation. When I read in Genesis that humans were supposed to live in the Garden of Eden, be fruitful and multiply, among the trees and plants and every flowering thing and all crawling and flying and other creatures, I hear that death was always part of God's intention. The cycle of life and death is woven into every species, every ecosystem, even rocks, which are created from sand and dirt, then eroded back to sand by water. Water evaporated or transpired, then returns to earth as rain. All of God's creation is in cycle, infinitely. There are myriad genius ways to cycle from life to death, to life to death, to share the resources of this good earth. If humans were always intended to live in the Garden of Eden, and if we were supposed to eat from the tree of life and live forever, creation would be a snow globe, static. And there could not be any fruitful multiplying because I trust that God knows how exponential growth works. God designed a world in which death is an ending, but always also a beginning. We started a garden this spring. I bet a lot of you did too. It's an easy mistake to think that a garden starts with a seed, with new life. A garden starts with death. A garden starts with compost, with manure, with the end of something. Jesus preaches this in the passage Diana read from John, "A grain that dies will bear much fruit." I eagerly tore into seed packets this spring to start a bigger garden than we might have tried without COVID-19 keeping us at home and giving us more reasons to seek to share with our neighbors. We Crest Manor folks have been watching this garden together through our Zoom worship, and I'm going to pull it up on the camera for you. I did not bring all of the plants with us this weekend up from Lafayette. I brought a few of them. So this is Crest Manor's garden that we have been tending since our very first Zoom worship service when I planted those bulbs and seeds. Even the best organic heirloom seeds are useless without good dirt. And dirt, humus, from which we humans take our name, dirt is exemplary of divine design in which death feeds life. A thriving garden begins with death. Humans, our very name, comes from humus, from soil, just like Adam, whose name comes from Adam, soil in Hebrew. From dust, from dirt we come. To dust, to dirt we return. That's not a curse, and it's not an accident, and it's not an afterthought. From our creation, God scooped up Adam, dirt, from this good earth, formed it into a human shape. We have always been dirt and always been going to return to dirt. Every ending is a beginning, and that doesn't mean that the ending shouldn't be grieved. Often it is sad. Most of you have met our dog, Hannah. She showed up last August at Crest Manor, our clingy, quiet, sweet whippet companion who followed us everywhere. Hannah died in February, and even though we knew that day would come, our hearts were broken. Our beloved companion, she was with Philip for 10 years. A hole remains in our family, and we think of Hannah every day. And we also knew, well before Hannah died, that when she did, we would have a new space in our family. And we decided we didn't want to adopt another dog, and we never would pretend that we could fill the hole of Hannah. But we did feel called to foster a dog when the opportunity came along, to provide temporary home for perhaps a complicated dog. We've had a variety of those in our lives. So 10 days ago, a rescue called us because they needed a pet-free home in a hurry. A very pregnant dog had been found, abandoned or lost, and they didn't want her to give birth at the shelter. And even though we had never wanted to be a pet-free home, it is only because Hannah is dead that we had that opportunity to be Mabel's new beginning. And so she came to stay with us, and on Good Friday, she had 9 puppies. Talk about bringing life. We keep getting the question, how many puppies will you keep? Or will you keep Mabel? And I believe this is going to be harder as the weeks go by, but our answer is no, because Mabel reminds us how important it is to be available. So we will say goodbye to those 10 dogs in time, and this ending will create a home for a new beginning. We are living with a lot of endings and cancellations this year, and we should grieve them. Just because all endings are also beginnings does not mean the endings don't hurt. But as Gesson Claire Greenwood reminds us in Practicing in a Pandemic, we don't need the added pain of thinking we are cursed. According to a Buddhist legend, she writes, there once was a woman who sought out the Buddha after losing her baby to illness. Crazy with grief, she asked him for medicine to bring her son back from the dead. He replied he would give her this medicine if she brought him back a white mustard seed from the house of a family that had never experienced death. The woman went door to door searching for a family untouched by the loss of a loved one. Of course, she could never find such a family. She realized that death touches everyone. And in realizing the universality of grief and death, her suffering lessened. This story shows us that the feeling of things should not be this way is an additional and unnecessary pain on top of our inevitable suffering. We cannot avoid old age, sickness, and death, but we can remove the unnecessary assumption that things should be otherwise and the psychic pain this assumption causes us. We have an opportunity to heal aspects of our culture and our faith, to use this COVID-19 illness to heal our healthcare system, our electoral process, the denial of paid sick leave or family leave, all of those unlivable minimum wages. After all, COVID-19 isn't the most dangerous disease our world faces. Its danger depends on the frail and exploitative systems that we have created and justified over time, which means healing these illnesses requires more than voting the right person into office or giving money to good charities. Jesus lived and died this truth. He didn't tweak the temple taxation system. He overturned the tables. He could have suggested the dove sellers just lower their prices for the poorest of the poor, make it less burdensome to pay for God's favor. No, Jesus said the system cannot be tweaked into wellness. He didn't suggest Zacchaeus try not to cheat so much, but that Zacchaeus leave tax collection, return his ill-gotten gain 4 times fold. I could go on with examples, but I want to actually go to Christmas and then speed ahead to Easter and glean what it could all mean for us. Because in Luke we read, "And Mary gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no place for them in the inn." How do you picture the manger? I always see it in wood, even though I've read that that's not true, that it's not accurate. 2,000 years ago and today, limestone is much more available than wood is in Bethlehem. Anything that can be made of stone is made of stone. And shepherds still use natural caves for shelter and chip at rock to create mangers. Jesus came into flesh, made of earth like us, and laid in a stone bed. We read in Matthew chapter 27, "When it was evening, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who was also a disciple of Jesus. He went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then Pilate ordered it to be given to him. So Joseph took the body and wrapped it in a clean linen cloth and laid it in his own new tomb, which he had hewn in the rock. He then rolled a great stone to the door of the tomb and went away. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary were there, sitting opposite the tomb. Dust to dust we live and die, dirt to dirt, stone to stone. Jesus shows us the way in every way. To live an abundant life, to live and die, as God desires us to live and die, held in the holy earth, dust, dirt, stone, not to save us from death, but to save us from thinking that death is a curse, a problem, an eternal end. You've probably heard the phrase cradle to grave in a business context, perhaps when citizens ask companies to take responsibility for their products from cradle, from creation, to grave, disposal. Jesus doesn't just teach us how to live, he teaches us how to die. There is no cradle to grave in God's design because there is no waste. There is no disposing of anything in God's design. All of us, all of our living and our dying, has a purpose, a place, and is put to use in this good earth. Do you know anyone who has built their own coffin? Maybe you have. We celebrate when someone makes a cradle by hand, pouring love and craft into creating a home for a baby. What about building our coffins? Because we live in the truth that death creates life, becomes death, creates life, and we die in the truth as well. Sometimes we forget this blessed way that God designed creation, this blessed way that God designs us. So God sends outrageous reminders, empties a tomb, and the risen Christ is mistaken for or finally recognized as the gardener, the one who knows the garden starts not with a seed, but with good soil, where death is honored into new and everlasting life. Amen.